It's Primus Tracks with Josh, Frankie, and Sawyer.
What a couple of dumb shits.
Hello, Primates! You found Primus Tracks, congratulations! We are at Primus Tracks on Instagram and Twitter. I am Josh. Some of you listeners out there are probably feeling like my friend Frankie, like you're standing around waiting to be called. Some of you, like my friend Tim Sawyer, went over the falls decades ago. Gentlemen, welcome back.
Hey, Josh. Hey, Sawyer.
Hey, guys.
I've got a good feeling about today's podcast, let me tell you.
This is a great song, and we did a video for this song, too.
That's right, yeah. We've got a single with a video. Track 4, Over the Falls from the Brown Album. We're going to get to that in just a moment. We do have a little bit of business to take care of first. As you know, you can leave a 5-star review on Apple Podcast or Audible, or just send us a DM on Instagram, and your review will be read here on this very podcast. This 5-star review comes from Apple Podcast from somebody named MP Wild, who says, "Good stuff, Maynard. Love the live history of each track. Love the breakdown of the bass parts. Especially love the breakdown of the drum parts." This guy loves a lot of stuff. "I'm a guitarist, so hearing these drum breakdowns is eye-opening. This podcast has reinvigorated my love of this band. Larry Lalonde for World Dictator. Soya for Vice World Dictator." Oh, very good. Josh and Frankie deserve an award for podcast excellence. I don't know about that, MP Wild, but I'll take it. And MP Wild ends with this, and I said this a while ago, so if you give us a variation on Primus lyrics with your own in there, I'll do it in my best Les Claypool. So this one goes like this. "I ain't one for poetry, ain't one for prose, ain't one for the scent of a springtime rose. But there is one fact that I do know, I sure get a kick out of that there Joshy and Frankie show." And there's that one. There you go. We have a little bit of miscellaneous debris today.
Yeah, I have a couple of things. First of all, I want to give a shout out to Eric D for bringing Primus Tracks to the National Gallery of Australia. Thank you so much for that.
That's right. It looks like he slapped a sticker somewhere nearby.
He did. Yeah, that's one of our newest claims to fame.
That's right. We're all over the world coming to a neighborhood near you to scare your kids. Be ready. Yeah.
And second, I would like our listeners to check out a new blog by McMarkey V, or maybe it's MC Markey 5. I don't know. He just posted this really fascinating, almost forensic research that he did in order to discover the correct dates and venue when Primus performed in Rome back in 1990. As you know, we have really good quality recordings of these shows, but the exact dates and locations were a mystery for a long time. Well, this guy completely uncovered the whole mystery, and you can read all about it on his blog.
Whoa.
When this kind of information comes up, you have a spreadsheet and there's gaps, and you went...
I filled them up.
Phil.
Well, it looks like we can find this blog at medium.com, and the username is MCMarkeyV or McMarkeyV, and it looks like, oh, there is all kinds of information here. I'm going to sit here and read this while you guys talk about Primus.
So he uncovered Italian dates and information about Italian dates.
Yeah.
90. Okay.
Yeah.
And he promised that his next post will be about some Dutch Primus shows. So that's awesome. Something to look forward to.
Yeah, for sure. We have another piece of miscellaneous debris, Frankie, and it comes in the form of news, not to date the podcast, but our good friend Les Claypool, he has an official Instagram account now, and he teased something very cryptic. I'm not sure what he's teasing. Got some ideas?
I'm leaning towards a solo album, probably with tons of hilarious and poignant observations about modern times.
That'd be all right. The post itself, of course, is very short and very cryptic. It's hard to tell what's going on there. Soya, I'm looking at you. I know you know.
Well, you know, I have no knowledge of any of this. This is new news to me.
Oh, come on.
Right now. I'm not kidding. Guys, I don't lie to you guys. I don't hold things back. Yep. I have information about something as petty as Les opening an Instagram account.
It's got to mean something if he's going to take the effort to do that.
Yeah.
He might be the new bass player for Megadeth.
That's true, yeah. Yes, know? Hopefully he can behave himself.
Well, you know, Les is a family man. I don't know if he's going to get in the troubles that Dave from Megadeth did.
But. Dave Ellefson. Yikes. Yeah, so keep an eye on at Les Claypool there on the Instagram, and I think we'll
keep your eyes peeled, as he suggested.
That's right.
I have no idea. I have no idea, guys. I don't know what you're talking about. That's new news to me right now in this moment.
He'll tell us off air. It is time to talk about track four from the Brown album, Over the Falls. My understanding, Frankie and Soya, is that the label, Interscope, actually pushed this to be the first single off of the record, but I believe it was Les and maybe Dave Lefkowitz that convinced them to go with Shake Hands with Beef. Does that sound right?
Yeah.
Okay. I think that's in the book. I can't recall where
I don't remember them pushing this one as the first one. I remember that it was pushed as definitely a single down the road once we got going.
Yeah.
Shake Hands with Beef was the first single. Like I said, I'm just a sidecar, you know, so I don't get all the memos and what's going to happen up front, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Well, it definitely turned out that this one was the second single, or down the road, as you said, and it even got a video treatment, a pretty interesting video treatment. We've talked about it before, but I think we'll circle back around to it. And as we always do when we have a new track to discuss, we go to live history.
All right. So this song was premiered in June. In Germany, you know, during the European leg of the Brown album tour back in 1997. It was performed extremely consistently, just like the other single, during the entire year of 1997. And then just a few occasions in 1998, it became sort of rare during that year. Then, as you know, it completely vanished from set lists until the triumphant return of Primus in 2010. At that point, though, it was a completely different song. So when we refer to the performances of the Brown album tour, Les would play the song exactly like the album version on an upright bass. Starting with 2010, he switched to his dobro, and they would jam on the song, particularly the intro, and then Les always has a funny speech in the middle. And then it's time to go to Lurland, you know?
Yes, indeed.
Some of these performances, you know, have really memorable and really hilarious speeches. I particularly remember the one where Les is talking about Diamond Lure, the one where he's talking about the assless chaps, the one about the shark guitar. I mean, all of them are amazing. Yes. I picked a particular favorite for our live cuts today.
Very good, yeah.
And then the song was twangified in both incarnations of Do With The Twang, as a matter of fact. And those are some pretty interesting versions. And you're going to talk about that one, right, Josh?
Yeah, I encourage everybody to find the 2013 performance from the Troubadour in L.A. where Larry Lalonde showed up with his six-string banjo and traded licks with Kehoe for a while after doing...
Was that the Duo de Twang gig? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, I have a feeling you were there.
Twang so version.
Yeah, I was there. Yeah. Oh, yeah, I was there.
There was a really high-quality audience recording from somebody standing right in the front. And it's the whole thing, and you get Kehoe and Lur having a good time. And it's great. It's a fantastic recording, and it's a lot of fun to watch those guys play around together.
And there's also a version with Brain, right, on guest drums. I recall a moment when there was some sort of reunion moment because you had Les, Brain, and Lur on stage playing Over the Falls.
That was the Eddie Jennings benefit, correct?
Right.
Kehoe mentioned that. Yeah,
that would have been that, because it was not a Duo de Twang official gig, because that didn't happen on one of those gigs. So.
All right. Well, Over the Falls has not been played live since 2018. Your guess is as good as any as to why it got dropped from the sets.
What?
There was a point, I do have to mention that there was a point where it was so consistent, particularly in its placing before Leave and Cleave, that the Boulevard developed a nickname for this part of the show called
Cleave,
Over the Cleave.
Cleave Falls was like
Over the Cleave.
every single night.
Yep.
And word got to Les that fans were starting to get, you know, kind of tired of this song, so this was immortalized on some setlist art where you can see Brad Sands pointing at a laptop and telling Les, you see, they don't want Over the Cleave anymore. And Les drew himself with a tear rolling down his cheek because, as you know, he absolutely loves this song. Wow. They did remove Over the Falls from the setlist for a short while after that, but then it came back and then it disappeared again.
I'm glad you mentioned that setlist doodle, because that was kind of an amusing point where the diehards who were following the band around went, hey, I got that four nights in a row. But, you know, you're not playing for the three people that are doing that. But at the same time, it's one of those things where I remember the last time I got it, it must have been on the tour with Clutch, that it was the second or third night in a row I'd seen them, and I went, oh, they're doing it again. And I'm tired, so I sat down. It was like the first time I ever sat down at a Primus show. Got right back up afterwards, but it's one of those. It's a great tune, and it's really fun. Even the Over the Cleef doubleheader isn't terrible, but it is just funny that it just became a running joke for a while among us.
Yeah,
Primus.
You know, sometimes they would surprise you with a hats off after mm-hmm. Over the Falls, but that was kind of a rarity. Lee Van Cleef was much more certain.
That would have been cool for me to see that. But in that moment that I came back in that 4 or 5 years, 2013 through 17 or whenever that was, 18, never played Hats Off.
Yep.
Not once.
Yeah, it's pretty rare.
Lee Van Cleef Falls.
And the interesting thing is that the fact that that complaint made it into the setlist art goes to show that at least there was a point in time where, you know, they kind of kept up with the opinions of the hardcores in the Bullboard.
A little bit, I suppose. Taking the temperature every once in a while. That doesn't mean that we have any power or anything, but at some point, you know, word gets around sometimes. People check things out. So
I think that it does come around, though, Josh.
Yep. You think so?
If Brad Sands is, like, paying attention because he's the manager and he's seeing what people are saying, and he's going to relay that to Les privately, you know, like in the dressing room before the show, and go, dude, a lot of people don't want to hear that. Mm-hmm. For decades, it might not make any difference, but at one point it might go, oh, the fans don't want Lee Van Cleef and Over the Falls every single night, every single show.
Yeah.
They want Jerry Was a Race Car Driver.
Professor the Butter.
Every single night, you know, it's like it's tough replaying songs that you recorded. It's not like you made a movie and you made it and you go away and do some promo and then whatever,
then you're done.
You're done with it.
Yeah.
You don't have to act that part again, you know?
Yep.
Music, you have to play it and up to expectations. And
yeah, that's tough. I mean, you're not going to please, you know, people said it for years. You're not going to please everybody all of the time. So
you can't ever
pick and choose, you know? Well, that's funny you say that, or it's funny that we're talking about this, because the My Name is Mud and Jerry duo of songs to round out most sets recently, you know, you can piss and moan about that all you want, but those are fan favorites. They're not going away. That'd be silly. Yeah. So you can moan about Lee Van Cleef, but as soon as you go, I don't want to hear My Name is Mud, everybody's going to give you that look. Yeah. Like, what? Get out of here. So interesting point.
I mean, I'm not trying to say that those two songs are bummers in the set, but that Les drives things down people's fucking throats. You get these two songs every single time. It's like, come on, man, change it up, dude.
I think that was the spirit behind it for sure. Was just that. Yeah. Change it
I'm
up
not
a
saying,
little bit. Give
what I just said was not dissing Les's approach to doing what he did. That Brad Sands finally was able to go with his computer going, look, the fans don't want to hear the same two songs every single night.
Maybe he saw the picture I photoshopped of me with a gun in my mouth, you know, just like, don't play it again. I don't know. I didn't actually do that. But this is an interesting one, because it is a live staple, or was a live staple. We have 372 documented performances, and that's across all acts, so that includes Do It a Twang. And it's strange for me to say, Over the Falls has more performances than Pudding Time. What?
Yes.
True.
Pudding Time.
Pudding Time.
Pudding Time. Pudding Time.
Pudding Time. Fewer performances.
Wow.
Yes.
I can't wait to text Brad Sands in about 10 minutes about that.
Well, I myself have experienced Over the Falls 9 times, and, you know, like I said, I'm not going to get too tired of it. It's fine. I like it. And here's the thing. You know, as we get into the music, it's 2 minutes and 40 seconds. So on the record, it flies right by. It's a nice compact song. And then live, you get a nice demonic Larry Lalonde solo. You can't beat that.
No, beyond anything, you get Larry Lalonde playing an acoustic and doing some of his twanging on the acoustic and not on the electric, you know?
Since 2010, he'd been doing the tune on his Fender, just with a clean tone. But In the years prior to that, he was playing a hollow body, like in the video. Because there's,
I've never seen Lur. Well, I guess yeah. In the later days, yeah, those last tours, he didn't have an acoustic. Right out. In the old days, we had a funky old piece of shit, crappy ass guitar, old Gibson that was worth $2,000 that he found at a pawn shop.
Oh wow!
That, I'm just kidding. I'm joking.
But oh wait, yeah.
It was like a really Monopoly cool money. Old guitar, and that's what he used. And we had to bring it out. I had to walk out of the room and tune it on the Brown Tour in the hallway because if anything was sound around it, you couldn't tune it. You know, and I'd run back in and hand it to him, and they do hats off or that or. Mm-hmm. Over the Pulse, you know. Yeah.
And is that the same one that he used in the video?
Likely, yes.
Okay. I couldn't recall off the top of my head.
Very likely, yes.
Okay. And if you want to see that guitar in action outside of the Over the Falls video, you can see some live footage from 97. Particularly, I think, a favorite of Frankie's and mine, the Rock Palace from Germany.
Oh, yes.
Which
absolutely.
Wonderful audience footage. Very 90s. Very.
Is that the one with Brain where the audience just are like, could give a shit and they're just sitting there watching.
Yeah, it's a really weird audience.
Yes,
yeah.
Very laid
back. But the
back
performance
audience.
Is amazing.
Great. That was a great night. We met Steve Winwood that night.
Oh, that's
he was on after right. Primus and we walked off and they're all sweaty and he was walking on and he stopped and wanted to say hi.
Oh,
so
rad.
We met Steve Winwood. It was like, oh, wow, cool. Hey, dude.
He's no slouch. Yeah, right
you
on.
You guys are great. And we're all standing there going, you have no fucking idea who you're talking to right now,
You're talking to three heavy Steve.
Well, we didn't care because we were all big Steve Winwood fans. You know, it's like, how can you deny Steve Winwood? We're like enamored that the guy actually stopped and said hi. You know,
yeah,
it was really cool. A really cool moment.
That's excellent. That just adds to the legend of that show. Yeah. Frankie
yeah,
and
we saw, I think Fish played that night as well. They were on the side stage on that era. Another festival we did on the same run. We did, and Fish, and we went over and hung out and watched Fish at some tent. Whatever.
And you'd know those guys. Oh, yeah. You'd known those guys for a few years at that point, or at least Primus had. Because they.
No, yeah, that might have been our first interactions with Fish was around then.
Was it then? Oh, I thought for some reason 94 is sticking in my head. Frankie, help me out.
I mean,
weren't they on stage?
You could talk to Les. He might have known Trey before that, but that might have been the first time we got our feet in the Fish water, you know?
Nice. Nicely done. Nice pun. You win. Well, let's talk about the track itself. We have this nice, compact 2:42 track. To me, it really does seem like a good idea for a single. It doesn't sound like your traditional Primus tune, but maybe that's why it just seems so fitting for a Primus single. It moves along nicely. Unlike Golden Boy last week, which kind of flips A-B-A-B with a solo tossed in there, we actually have an A part and a B part and a chorus that actually bridges those parts, the stood by waiting to be called, right? We actually have a chorus with some interesting instrumentation and an interesting melody. So there's a lot of compelling stuff going on in this tune, whereas last week we were talking about how funky and herky-jerky it was. This one really flows nicely.
It does. But listening to this song all week, gathering up to this episode like I did, there's no guitar solo, goddammit. Why did Lur not get a piece of action out of this one? On the recording, obviously, live, Frankie can attest, there's probably some solos that happened. I don't know.
But, yeah, I'll talk about that in a moment.
I mean, that's my only thought on that, you know, of what the arrangement is. It's still A, B, A, B, A, B. A lot of Brown Album songs are doing that, you know.
Yeah, it's really cohesive, though, and I am curious maybe as to why there isn't one, but it's okay without one in the sense that the song moves along, and like I said, they're both playing on the guitar and bass some busy lines there, so this sounds like you could have three or four people playing this kind of instrumentation with as many notes as are flying around. So, you know, if you're listening closely, it's obviously, yes, there's two guys, and they're both doing these things at the same time, and to me, this is a great example of how they can do this. It's not always that one instrument is the lead and the other is support. One's doing the backbeat and the other one's doing the main riff. They can work together like this and do two busy things at once, and it sounds really good. So, you know, this is something
Actually, Josh, I haven't noticed how busy the bass line was until I watched the video for the first time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that moment in the intro when Les is doing that thing with his hand, like he's sliding down really quickly on the neck. Jesus Christ, that made me realize what a hard song it must be to play on the upright.
Yeah, so the bass, you're right, it is a busy line. And or sorry, I'm going to refer back to that concert from Germany with that upright. It's a nice, compact, small electric upright. So unlike in the video where he's laboring on that big pawn shop upright, he's using this little electric one. And it's so satisfying just to watch his fingers flow down the yeah. strings during the verses. And he's just going across down all the strings. It's oddly mesmerizing. And then you're talking about that high, those high eighth notes. That
yeah,
part, right? Yeah.
Those are crazy.
So he's sliding up to hit those, and it's also marking the transition to the next part. So it's serving two purposes there. And it yeah. sounds really cool. It's, you know, I was struggling because I'm thinking this doesn't sound like a folk song, but it sounds like some kind of, you know, just old time jug band song without sounding like an old time jug band. I'm having, like, you know, I can't really put a finger on it, but there is some kind of style of music, I think, that they may have cribbed from, but at the same time, they probably did this without even thinking about it, and it's just ringing a non-existent bell for me. You know, I can't place it right now. So, and it's definitely different on the dobro when we get those live versions. It's much more bouncy with the dobro version, but with this one, it just flows much yeah, like, yeah. I guess, the water that the character is about to embark mm-hmm. upon.
So. Well, then I'll interject, Josh, yep. that, you know, these guys are trying to come up with ups and downs with the recording of the record. You know, it wasn't just like plowing through it like the old days, you know, like creating scenes and Shake Hands with Beef or Camelback Cinema. And then it's like hats off. And then it's like this one was another one of those like departures where they weren't doing or trying to fit in like fillers. So Les was trying to break it up into this type of styles in his head that he was trying to convey as the record, you know? And I think that this one fell right in there with hats off, you know?
Right. Yeah.
Is like a break it up kind of song, you know?
Yeah.
And even though I said there's no solo, that sucks, but it was what it was. It was a moment in recording that we just went to a mellow place for a second, you know?
Right, yeah. I wonder if it kind of followed the punch bowl, not formula, but the punch bowl idea of, like you were saying, we have our four-string songs, we have our six-string fretted songs, we right. have the upright songs that are going to be a little more laid back. Is that kind of where?
Right.
Okay.
I think that at that moment, it's the same as punch bowl, where Les really had it in his head that it's like, I have to do a six-string fretted. I have to mm-hmm. do a six-string fretless. We have to do a stand-up song. Like, yep. he had this, like, formula of like everybody wants this, so I have to make sure all of that is in the bigger package of what the record's going to be.
Okay, yeah.
And with Brown Album, it really got diluted a little bit, you know, like the fretless, the rainbow bass kind of went away, you know, uh-huh. and the six string fretted was in there, but it kind of went away, you know,
right? Yeah,
kind of got away from it all to say, I don't want any of that past jargon that everybody could reason with. I want to go do something new with brain. Let's do this. Let's try something totally different. And right. so the filler songs, filler, I mean by like changing the sound of Primus.
Yeah. Change up tracks. Yeah.
Were like these two songs, Hats Off and Over the Falls, are the ones for me that really were like the breakups, you know?
Mm-hmm. So a change up, a transition, something like that. Yeah. So it doesn't all sound the same one after another. That's not to say if you know, eliminated them, the whole album sounds the same, but it definitely changes the mood and definitely changes
it's like the flow, you know, like we're making right. a record, you know, it's not like these days you make a single and you put it online and you hope you get 10 million hits, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's yeah. like you make a record and 10 songs have to ebb and flow through your oral experience of hearing them, you know?
Yeah, definitely.
And that was still the era of that going on. And that's where we were with that, you know?
Uh-huh. Yeah. This is an interesting one because it is pretty melodic. So it is a bit of a departure, although we have seen flashes of it on some other tracks leading up to the Brown Album. So Les is getting more into melody when he's playing, but also singing. He's hitting the notes. You know, he's following some of the bass notes when he's doing the chorus. So he's singing notes, which is that little C part, stood by and waited to be called, time to go over yeah. the falls. So we get yeah. Some changes
it's,
in there. Yeah.
It's kind of strange that Over the Falls is pretty melodic, as you mentioned, and Shake Hands with Beef is quite catchy. Beef got performed on TV, and both songs were featured heavily on the set list for the tour. And there was even artwork commissioned for the singles, but they were relegated to promotional material. They were not released commercially. It's pretty strange that they didn't push those singles further. considering the songs are so strong.
Yeah, so you mentioned something around that, like it just didn't take off the way that the previous record did.
It doesn't matter how hard the band works at what they've achieved recording. If the public doesn't accept it, or the people that don't even know anything about it accept it and make it even bigger, then on to the next.
Right.
That's American music, man.
Yeah.
Especially for independent bands like Primus, you know?
Yep.
Hey, great success in the independent world when that was jamming back in the 90s, you know? Hey,
right.
So here we are in the late 90s, and it's like they're fighting, they're clawing their way up to the top of the air hole to go, we're still good. Come on, you know?
Right, and it's really hard to stay up there once you climb that mountain, and it didn't last too long for them.
Well, dude, the mountain they were climbing was the major labels, you know.
Right,
they were in that realm, you know. They weren't independent, just doing what they did like they used to do. They got into that realm, and it wasn't bad. It was great because now we're all around the world Primus fans, you know.
Yeah, yeah, and that's awesome. Yeah,
it's a tough mountain to be trying to climb up when the ice is slippery, man. You know, it's like you really got to claw your way in there. And Les didn't want to kowtow to that, you know. In a song like Over the Falls, there's no guitar solo.
Right.
It's dark. It's deep. There's a great plot. And the video was crazy and kooky. And it's like, he's like, there, here's my piece of art.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
And if you don't like it, fuck off.
That's for sure. The other thing is, as this band is making its way up with Caesar Cheese, Pork Soda, and getting some play with Pork Soda, and then a ton with Punch Bowl, when you look at the top singles of 1993, 1995, and 1997, there's a massive shift in just a few years. Because in 93, and I'm using this as a blanket term, you know, grunge was ruling the day, and Primus just got lumped in with them. We've talked about that, right? So they were kind of part of the bigger picture that was emerging. And then in 95, you know, they just had this hit that was otherworldly and just caught the imagination of a lot of people. But then in 97, you're getting, like, you know, the Third Eye Blind song. That's the kind of singles that are out there now, right? It's totally different. The landscape's different. And, you know, Primus probably didn't fit into that narrow window of what, you know, the mainstream wanted in 97, or what the mainstream was being pushed.
At that same moment, when that was going on, Third Eye Blind was like top of the world, you know, and that kind of pop, that stuff was going on, you know. Les was like, okay, we touched into that realm of pop stardom, but that's not what we're about.
Right.
And then we get to the Tim Quits, Brain Comes In, we get to the Brown Album, and it's like, let's just go and do what I want to do. And I don't care what anybody thinks. I don't care if the radio stations don't pick it up. But at the same time, we're going to put out a single and let's just see what happens. You know, it wasn't like, let's hire the producer and let's make it bear, woo, send it out. MTV, woo. MTV hated Primus. So whatever. So, you know, that's why the Brown Album was as dark as it was, because it wasn't driven by mainstream media.
And I think we've mentioned this before. It was almost like this record was made as a dare for people to actually consume it in a pop culture way. Just go like, we dare you to play this on the radio, you know.
Dude, since we've been doing this podcast, I will tell you right now, I am amazed at the comments that come up on our feeds of Instagrams and stuff where they say, my favorite Primus album ever.
Yes. Yeah, ever. Absolutely.
Ever. And on Primus continue. Sucks, the Facebook thing. Favorite one, better than all. I'm like, wow. I'm really blown away, dude, at that.
Right.
I don't dislike it, but it's like, man.
It's okay. It's like, think about, there's other stuff.
Not great to me, man. It's like the tones, and we just went for what we went for. Just, man, are you really, you fans, you like this?
Yeah. Okay. Well, people do. They've got a little soft spot for it. That's for
it's
sure.
It's trippy, man. Whew. Yep. Sailing the Seas of Cheese, man. I hear that shit, and it blows my mind every time.
Yep.
Man.
Yeah, it does. A Brown Album does the same for a contingent of Primus fans, which is interesting.
I know.
Huh?
I know.
Let's talk about the drums briefly. I mean, this is in 3/4 time or 6/8 time, however you want to delineate it. And it seems like Brain's playing it straight mostly, right? But he does get some tasteful fills in there. But Soya, through your listens, I mean, you said something, I think last week, that Brain was kind of restrained on the recording of this album for the most part. I mean, what are you hearing in this track?
Brain really didn't have any say into what was going to happen, you know? Mm-hmm. Les was the captain of the ship. And he said, let's do this or let's do that or play a beat here or play a beat there. And it all transpired with each moment where he felt that's a song, you know. I can't really say that Brain had a part in what was going to happen. He waited for Les to say, let's do this or let's do that. And Brain sometimes would get the, come on, dude. And then Camelback Cinema came out of it.
Right. You know? So this one was more along the lines of, all right, we're doing this thing in 6/8. Give me one of those.
And right on.
Give me that swinging thing.
It's going to be a mellow one. He's got stand up. So Brain knew it was going to be one of those mellow songs on the stand up. So.
Yeah. Okay. Do you remember, did he just record it with his normal, well, I mean, obviously recorded with the drum kit, but we saw Jay Lane plays it with the felted mallets. I don't know if Brain was doing that too on the record or if he just played it.
With live Brain never played with mallets. No.
Yeah. So Brain's pretty much playing it straight. He does have some nice tasteful fills with some of those rolls on those toms, which sounds really good. So, you know, I'm just to kind of wrap up the instrumentation part, all three of these guys are kind of busy, but everything works so well together and they're all playing interesting parts. And man, it really, and it, like I said, it just moves. It just comes together. So it's hard to find fault in a song that's here and gone, especially with the musical and lyrical content, which of course we'll get to lyrics. But yeah, tell us about the video, Soya, because you experienced that as well. We talked with Mark Kaur about it, but I'm curious about your experience.
We did that at Baker Beach down at these installs for some wartime stuff, World War II.
Yeah. That's
concrete
right. Yeah.
Structures that are down there that were supposed to hold big cannons or whatever. And we set up the drums and the amps on one of those structures and everyone dressed period.
Yeah.
And we got this 1920s drum set for Brain that had coconuts on it and some funny stuff. It was hilarious, dude. That was one facet of that video. I mean, the other facet is that old dude in the garage building the vessel to go over the falls, right?
Right, yeah, the Tom Waits lookalike guy, and that was Les's grandpa's garage, I think.
Oh, can I tell you about that?
Yes, please.
Well, so first of all, Les recalls that they spent very little money on the video, but it's one of his favorite videos that he's ever done. Like Soya mentioned, the performance portion of the video was shot at the Marine Headlands, which is a hilly peninsula at the southernmost end of Marin County in California. And the parts of the video that show the construction of the vessel, those were shot in Les's grandfather's garage, which was full of tools hanging on the walls.
Yeah.
And that was legitimately the original stuff. Yeah.
So they cast this guy to play the role of the scientist building the vessel, because originally Les wanted Tom Waits to do the part, but Tom was not interested. So they cast this guy instead. There are two interesting things about the video. First of all, there's a behind-the-scenes little featurette in the video plastic tape, which I'm sure that you have seen before, which is really cool.
I have not.
Okay. And the second thing is that, as I mentioned, the garage is full of tools, and that refers specifically to a Bucket of Bernie Brains track. Do you guys know which one?
Give me a second. Gee whiz. A Bernie Brains track? Are you messing with me?
Spicy noodle song.
Oh, my gosh. I can't even think of half of the tracks on that record right now. All right. Lay it on me. I have no idea off the top of my head.
All right. So there's this instrumental track on Bucket of Bernie Brains called Hip Shot from the Slap. And the only lyric that Les says during the entire song is, what you gonna do about it?
Right.
So he explained during a live performance that when he was young, his grandfather taught him how to use all those tools in the garage. And every time something was broken or he had to fix something, his grandfather would tell him, what you gonna do about it, huh? So that's why Les incorporated that into the song. So basically the song is about his grandfather teaching him how to use those tools in the garage.
Oh, wow. I never would have guessed Hip Shot, man. That's hilarious. So there's two great things about that shed there. So they made the part of the video in there, and it's got its own song. And I recall Mark Kaur saying they barely had to move anything around, that shed was just perfectly set up for what they wanted.
Oh, my God. It was like a packed, you know, micro-scientist mechanical dude that just packed everything in there, and we just went in and brought in that prop of the vessel and set it on the work table there.
Yeah.
And went for it.
Wow. And, yeah. Because I believe Les directed it, but Mark helped with the photography, yeah. I think, or cinematography.
That's right.
Directs all of those videos. Yeah, yeah. Of course.
Okay.
Especially then.
So you have the band performance on the Marin Headlands. You have the Tom Waits lookalike. Actually, to me, he looks like Tom Waits and David Letterman had a baby. Like, that's because of the gap in his teeth, man. Exactly. I'm just like, it's Letterman.
He was a really nice dude, man. He was super cool.
Yeah, he was very emotive with his face, too. That guy does a fantastic job.
An actor, man. He played the part, dude.
Yeah. Do you remember that guy's name? I don't remember if he's...
No, freaking idea.
Okay. I'm sure
he'll tell you right now. Frankie, you know how like the camera cuts to pictures on the wall?
Yeah.
And then it creates a scene for the video?
Yeah.
The frame on this picture right there.
Oh, cool.
Is in that video. Oh, I have a couple of those frames left over from that video.
Awesome.
I got ZZ Top in one of the Over the Falls frames on that wall.
There you go. What a great use of that frame. Fantastic.
Come on, man. I just grabbed that shit. It was like, oh, there's some frames. I had to go to Goodwill and buy them all.
Yeah.
And they did the screenshot pictures of what it was about. They zoomed in on and we framed them and hung them on the wall in the dude's eccentric shop. And then at the end of the shoot, it was like, okay, all the props out. And it was like, I had this box of frames. I took all of them home because I got them at Goodwill for like 50 cents each, you know?
Right. Yeah.
That is one of them right there.
And then, those stills of the pieces of film, was that just found footage at somewhere? I don't know where you would find that in 97. Totally. That's fascinating.
Totally. It was just like found footage. Before phones, before, you know, like easy grab and go, someone took a screenshot on a computer downtown, processed it, brought it to us on a Kinko's printout, and we cut it out and put it in a $2 or a 50 cent Goodwill frame. Right? You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. And all those
now I'm really curious about the actor because I can't find any information about him anywhere.
Yeah, I would love.
We should have asked Mark Kaur when he was here.
He might not have known.
Yeah, he might not remember. I don't know if anybody.
This random actor that showed up on the set that day, and Les was the director, then Mark Kaur wouldn't have been involved.
Yeah.
He was going to be the actor.
So that guy just showed up, huh? No casting call. He just showed up. Wow.
There was a casting call, but Mark Kaur was not involved.
I'm kidding. Like, hey, you look like Tom Waits. You want to be in a video? Okay, sounds good, man. Who are you?
Here's some shoes. Here's a belt, dude. Please come in here.
Hey, pretend you're shining that thing. Hey, this guy's good. Let's keep him. Man. Yeah, it's a really nice video, too. It's a cool video. It's too bad it didn't get too much play, of course, out there in the world. But yeah, you know, it just fits the lyrical content, of course, so well, which the lyrics, very interesting lyrics. We have an interesting AABCCC pattern with the verses. Okay, that's your rhyme scheme. But then in the chorus, we come back to the B with the word called, right? Because it's in the first verse, we have broke out in laughter again, blah, 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 strapped him in. So there's your A's. And then he stood by and waited to be called. And then we come back to stood by and waited to be called, time to go over the falls in the chorus. So we have this interesting rhyme pattern. But to me, the lyrics are actually, of course, we have the theme of the guy getting in the vessel to go over the falls. He's preparing it in the video. For all this stuff going on, to me, this is really an exploration of anticipation, of waiting for an event. Here are the things that I pulled. We have this combination of anxiety of waiting for one's turn, right? So these guys are sitting around waiting. Of course, in this case, they're waiting to do something dangerous from what we gather, but they're just waiting their turns and they're, you know, the fake laughter, the nerves, and then they're just talking about absolutely anything else than what they're about to do to avoid thinking about it. So one of my favorite lines in all of Primus is, or of all of Les Claypool's, excuse me, is the quantity and quality of women, they lie.
Oh, I was going to mention that. Oh, that is absolutely incredible.
Fantastic lyric. Quantity and quality, of course, go together perfectly. But, you know, quantity and quality of women, they lie. They're shooting the breeze, but they're also probably trying to avoid thinking about this imminent danger. So they're making up stories, you know. Well, I remember this one lady.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
Josh, when you mentioned the guys talking, this is another perfect example of Les doing research and then incorporating the narrative into his lyrics in a very compact and very efficient way. He said that he investigated about many cases of people that went over the falls and how a lot of them didn't survive and just a few of them did.
Right. And so, specifically Niagara Falls, if I recall, correct?
Yes, that's right.
Yeah, there were a lot of instances of people doing that as a publicity stunt or to raise money for many, many years. Some people survived and came out almost unscathed, and some people, of course, didn't make it. So I was I was looking up some old instances of that. I can't remember her name, but there was a gal in 1901 who did it as a publicity stunt to raise money, and she went over the falls in a barrel. She was just like bleeding in one. She had a cut. That's it. She had one cut going over Niagara Falls in a barrel. How lucky can you be, right? Man. Yeah, that's
that dude that did it in the styrofoam ball was the best.
That was more recent, right? I can't recall when that was.
That was 20 years, 30 years ago. But yeah. Still, he just like went boink, boop, popped out. He's like, what? It's no big deal.
I had fun. Who wants to go next? Yeah. These guys are doing this thing. And to me, it's just that old-timey recklessness when people were just screwing around with machinery and going, I wonder what this does. You know, and you see this all the time where they either invent something brilliant or they blew their own head off. And you read about them either way. You know, it's a disaster or it's a rousing success. So,
or the people who used to have boxing matches with kangaroos.
Yes, that kind of thing, right? It was just this weird time where people were doing the most outlandish things. You know, people go, boy, the culture now is so terrible. People do the worst stuff. And I'm thinking, yeah, they didn't have video cameras until about 1897 when Edison was getting his shit together. You know, people did some really stupid shit back then. That, you know, they didn't record it. They wrote it down.
Yeah.
You know,
they wrote down what they saw.
Yeah, they wrote down what they saw, and half of it you go, that's got to be made up. But it's probably not.
Probably was not made up because nobody knew about fake news back then.
I mean, humans are strange. You know, somebody had to figure this out. Like, I can't go over these waterfalls in a barrel because the last guy that did it died, right? But then somebody else came along and went, I bet I could improve that barrel. Which is the most insane thing you could say, right? But this is how people think, you know? A human had to try and then go, yeah, don't do that. That
any
hurts.
Of those dudes back then had to have done it as a publicity stunt to raise money to make money, you know?
It was getting into that P.T. Barnum period of time where this guy, of course, had this traveling circus and it was all these curios and oddities. It was all about just getting suckers in there to see these things that were so outlandish. But they thought they were true. So
I've been to the Niagara Falls.
Yep.
I was there recently. I had the day off before we flew home was there. And went down there. It was the first time I'd ever been there. And it's like, it's a big national park now.
Yeah, it's big, beautiful, great place.
Even if you go back to those days of P.T. Barnum land, you know, you could easily cordon that area off and charge 25 cents for anybody that comes through this fence that we have here to go watch.
Yep.
This dude go over the falls. It's like people were amazed that somebody would even do that.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
And it's so suitable for a Primus song, particularly on this album.
It's awesome Les Fodder that he wrote a song about. You know? I mean, he did the research, Frankie, like you said.
Yeah. Yeah, and it totally fits with the vibe of this album, of course, because it's not a wacky, outlandish character, but it's somebody doing something way beyond the norm, which is kind of, you know, if I was going to distill
it's the Brown Album essence.
Yeah, if I was going to distill down the Brown Album lyrics, I was going to say
the Brown
exactly
Album
that.
This departure is it. Of the Jerry was a race car driver. We're going to find some deep, dark, weirdo shit over here.
Yeah.
People
and there's
beyond
still
the
characters
norm,
involved, you know?
I'm going to point to my favorite, absolute favorite line in this track, and possibly one of my favorite Les Claypool lyrics of them all, even beyond quantity and quality. Because in the second verse, we get, it seems like our protagonist gets some confidence because he admires his vessel for its symmetry, feeling 12 units shy of a bachelor's degree, which is
that's wonderful.
A fantastic couplet. Vessel symmetry, 12 units. I love 12 units shy of a bachelor's degree because it just flows. Just linguistically, those sounds flow.
Educators love those kind of things, dude.
They do. That would be me. I love that.
Oh, you are?
Thing.
Oh.
I've never talked about this before. Hi, I teach. Oh, okay. So,
are you going to go over the falls?
So now I might show my kids some found footage of it, though, and say, don't do this.
Show them the styrofoam ball, dude.
Sure. A better quality video of that. But that line of he admired his vessel for his symmetry, feeling 12 years shy of a bachelor's degree. When I see the word symmetry in lyrics or poems, Frankie, do you know where I go with it? The most famous example of the word symmetry in poetry?
Where do you go, Josh?
I go to William Blake. I don't know if you do, but I automatically go to Blake with his poem, The Tiger. So the first two couplets of that are, and it's one of the most famous poems. Like if you take a poetry class, you're probably going to read The Tiger. So it goes, "Tiger, tiger, burning bright in the forest of the night. What immortal hand or eye could frame this fearful symmetry?" And that always blew me away because he's got this rhyme scheme and he blows it up in the second couplet. Okay. "Burning bright in the forest of the night. What immortal hand or eye could frame this fearful symmetry?" Try? It doesn't make sense, but I just love how he does that, right? So he blows that up. But I always think of the word symmetry and I think of William Blake.
Yeah, there's something about that word. it just sticks out in poems and songs, kind of like Quicksand from David Bowie when he says divine symmetry. It's one of the most memorable lines in the song.
There you go.
I slipped in the nugget.
Sawyer, he got it by you, man.
Poetry.
Oh, we lost him at poetry. Okay, oh, that's the key, oh, Frankie. Cool. That's the key.
Yeah. Lose him first and then slide the nugget.
Yeah. Talk Bowie for an hour.
Yeah. I was not going pee fans out there. I was sitting here waiting for poetry moment to end.
All right, poetry corner is over. We've barely talked about the guitar part. It's really cool though, but
yes.
Guitar solos, Frankie?
Well, as we mentioned at the beginning, the upright was switched for the dobro, and they would begin the song with a slow drum beat by Jay Lane each night. And just like Sawyer recalls, every night during the Wonka tour, Here Come the Bastards would serve as the opportunity to project something related to the city they were playing at. Over the Falls kind of served a similar purpose before that, because Les would use it as an opportunity to engage the audience and share something funny or something special that happened that night. If not, he would just share some random anecdote. And the banter would lead to a guitar solo by Lur, which was always different, and it always involved humorous, possessed reference by Les, implying that the guitar solos were evil.
Right, yes.
Yeah. So one of my
that is
personal...
very legitimate, though.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Totally.
They're possessed, all right.
One of my personal favorite banters is from New Year's Eve 2013. Josh was there. When Liz jokes that they will do a Van Halen New Year's Eve, and oh, Larry right. is going to wear assless chaps.
That's right, I forgot.
Yeah. Another hilarious banter involves Liz recalling the shark guitar incident.
Shark guitar.
It revolved around him attempting to purchase a shark-shaped guitar for Larry, only to be declined by the shop owner. He then visited the store again with Larry, and that's when the owner gave it away to Larry. So he had deep admiration for Lur, but not for Liz. So the banter is extremely humorous because after all the buildup around the instrument, it turns out to be this really soft par instrument, which they obviously discarded later.
Yeah.
And there's also another favorite of mine in which Les warns the audience that Larry is wearing civilian pants instead of his regular concert pants. So they should be advised that there could be a Lenny Kravitz incident if Larry gets carried away with his solo.
Oh,
that's
man.
Funny.
That's a good one. I hadn't heard that one. That's funny.
I think I was there for the shark guitar incident.
Yeah, you probably were.
What year was that?
2013, right, Josh?
Yeah, that's 2014,
I think.
I remember the shark guitar showed up,
yeah.
And it was like, oh, geez.
Yeah, that was crazy.
Lur played it live.
Yeah, he ended up playing it once or twice, but Dan told me it's long gone. He
somehow disappeared off the back of the truck.
Yeah.
It's gone. I've never seen it since.
Yeah, it's gone. That's for sure.
If there's one thing that we can appreciate about Over the Falls, even after it became so monotonous in the set list, is that it did give Lair that chance to shine.
Not on the record, but live.
Right, yeah. Live, yeah. And the first one I caught, it was the Oddity Fair, and he just murdered You know, that one bluesy, is amazing. Bluesy, crazy stuff. He was just going all pentatonic on our asses, and it just sounded so good because he was throwing in all the lurisms that we know and love.
Yeah, Lurland, so right?
It was my first taste of true Lurland.
Well, dude, let's put it to what Brain said, that he wished they could have done some runs and worked these songs out, you know?
Something like that could happen back
then. As a lot of these songs were kind of thought out or made up on the spot.
Yeah.
A little more worked out on the Brown album with that jam room that we had. This song was not one of them, but what if Lur had the moment to get that on record and get some crazy on record? You know, that did not happen because we were making the Brown album and they made that song up in the studio. So,
yeah. Yeah. I wonder if it wouldn't have fit with the vibe they were going for in studio, but my hands are up because I don't know.
I want to love. I want to hear it.
I'm going to take care of my 1897 connection, quickly becoming everybody's favorite segment on this podcast. I hear no agreement, so I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to take your silence for assent. Thank you. So considering that this is about guys going over waterfalls in barrels and developing technology and water vessels and that sort of thing, the best 1897 connection I could really find was that on May 17th, 1897, it was the launch of the USS Holland, which was designed by a guy named John Philip Holland, and this would have been in New Jersey, and this was the first submarine, interestingly enough, having the power to, and I'm quoting Wikipedia, having the power to run submerged for any considerable distance, and the first to combine electric motors for submerged travel and gasoline engines for use on the surface. I had no idea. The things you learn.
Well, if you're shy of a bachelor's degree.
Man, I feel like it after reading that sentence, too. Yeah. Gee whiz.
Josh, you're treading David Bowie waters now with me starting to cut you off.
Hey, I took like it's 17 seconds and then we move on. You didn't like the Sausage King last week? Come on. He was the best.
Josh, did you find a cover for this song?
I did find a cover. We should hear it. This was actually posted to YouTube 10 years ago and it was buried in the results for an Over the Falls cover. This is from a band called Liver Green and this is their cover of Over the Falls. It's guitar, stand-up bass and drums. And a female vocalist, who you will hear, and an accordion player. Pretty cool.
Wow, she sounds like she's from Estonia or something like that.
Yeah, Eastern Europe, maybe Russia. Yeah, I'm
wow, not sure. That was really cool.
It is cool with the
that was pretty
of
cool.
Accordion.
She really made the melody shine.
Right. Yeah, she was bringing it with the singing. It sounded really good.
Heartfelt.
Yeah,
it sounded like a traditional number.
It really does. That's where because I'm trying to find like that. Spot where what in the world were they, you know, where were they coming from when they wrote this song? But it does sound like a traditional number when you add an accordion and this kind of vocal too. It's really great.
I was asking, do you think they've ever heard of Primus or they just found that song and it was random?
That's a good question.
You know what I mean?
I'm inclined to think that anybody who covers Primus is a Primus fan.
Yeah, that's a good point. Frankie.
It'd be hard not to be. Yeah. Just go like, what
but
is this?
Still, I mean, you find weird stuff along the way and you think nobody knows who it is and you cover it and think nobody's going to know that you're playing somebody else's song that nobody else knows.
Right. Yeah. And the other thing,
a lot of people know about.
The other thing I like is they're essentially playing it straight. But I was looking through the YouTubes for guitar covers, just seeing what people were coming up with for what they thought Larry was playing. Plus, I was watching some of that live footage, and this guitarist was playing bar chords for all of the for all of the chorus, but I'm pretty sure Larry stays in first position and he's playing those first position chords that are not bar chords for the most part that part. Because I was strumming it out and I was trying to figure it out, and I think I have it, but I'm not going to play it for you guys. Ha ha.
All right, so this is a performance from the concert that we were talking about, you know, the one in Germany with the weird audience. So this is Rock Palace, 1997, soundboard recording, professionally shot footage. It's actually the first ever rendition of Over the Falls live. And you can kind of tell that they rehearsed it pretty well because it was absolutely perfect.
There it is. There's those first position chords I'm talking about. I really like the rolls that Brain's doing there. They sound so good on live, man. Love that sound.
I think it's a really great performance. I just wanted to share that one, like, to give you a general idea of what Over the Falls sounded like in 1997. Mm-hmm. But
that's not a really good interpretation, Frankie, because that show particularly was under a weird tent like Shoreline Theater in Mountain View. And that's why it sounds so weird, bombastic, and trebly.
Yeah. So, but the following one, I like it a lot more because of the drum sound. And I'm sure that Tim had a lot to do with that one. You know, it sounds incredibly sharp and precise. And the rest of the instrumentation, particularly the upright, this is a thick performance, all right? Just like last week, we heard a thick Golden Boy. Now I brought a thick Over the Falls for you. And so let's listen to a thick performance of Over the Falls at Roskilde Festival. Yeah, can you hear that?
Fat. Tempo too.
That's a board tape, dude.
What's wrong with it?
It's a board tape.
Yeah, but what's wrong with it?
That is like what the front of house guy recorded, but you're not hearing what it does in the audience speakers. That's just what he was doing to amplify out to the crowd.
I know. I love soundboards.
It sounds good
terrible,
to me.
Terrible.
I love it.
Now
we have Santiago de Chile 2011 with hilarious banter. And then some Lurland moment. Are you ready?
Is this an audience recording?
Yes.
Okay.
Ah, Santiago, Chile! We meet again. In this dusty zone that you call, whatever the hell you call this place. I would speak Spanish to you, but I do not know how. I could say, ¿Dónde está la biblioteca? ¿Dónde están los baños?
Gringo.
And these women last night were trying to teach me how to say, I am a terrible chicken. Something about terrible apoyo. But I knew I'd fuck it up, so I didn't even try it.
Oh, gosh.
So, I'd like to introduce to you a man who is not a terrible chicken. He's quite a fine hunk of poultry, actually. A fellow by the name of Mr. Lur Lalonde. He's silent but deadly. Yes. That there is Lur Lalonde, and like, are you going to say something, Lur? Speak to the folk. These are the folk.
Hi, folks.
There you go.
That's our Lur.
He used to be in a band called Possessed. And he has since found the Lord. And then he lost the Lord. And then he found him again. And now he says he's misplaced the Lord. But Lur communicates via his six-string piece of furniture. What you got today, Lur? You got a red Fender Mustang. Hey, boys and girls, look at that. Looks like a 57 Chevy to me, buddy. So, Lur, do that voodoo that you do every now and again. One, two, three,
have to fade it out now, otherwise we're going to listen to the whole thing. There's many more minutes of that track, but that sounds great. That's yeah. Kind of that Lur land wet that I got back then too.
That's Jay Lane on drums.
Yep.
Yeah
definitely. Ah man, that's nice. And I'll say it every time we mention it, or every time we say Chile, I have to say the greatest Primus fans in the world are in Chile, because they
yes.
are just wild.
You know what they say, hot tamale, Chile tomorrow.
Oh, man. Thank you for sharing that one, Frankie. I love those Chile recordings.
That was good.
Yeah,
that was a great listen, man. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, guys. So the last one is another audience recording, and I want to share some more Lurland moments with you. This one is from Dallas, Texas.
I always have it.
That there's Lur Lalonde in the flesh. In the flesh, in the pink. The real McCoy. No filler, no imitation. Sliced, diced, and julienne. Ladies and gentlemen of Dallas, Texas. Exactly what you need, and that is a firm and fiery and semi-intoxicating dose of Mr. Lur Lalonde.
That part right there was just Lur Land in a nutshell.
Yeah.
With all that discord going on. Oh, man. That's outstanding.
Brilliant song, brilliant album, incredibly overlooked, incredibly underrated. A masterpiece in terms of production, recording, and innovation.
Is this your copy you wrote, Frankie? That's pretty good. You should be in advertising, man. Wow.
What are we talking about?
So I just cracked another beer for those of you listening at home.
Frankie went off on a tangent right there.
Whew. It's like he was reading a poem. Nah, it's a nice track. I like it. It's short, sweet, to the point. Really fun lyrics. And man, yeah. A lot of people say this, you know, it deepens their appreciation for the band. It's working for me too. This is a track that I remember going, it's all right. But now I'm like, yeah, it's. Now I'm thinking, yeah, it's fantastic. So it really has grown on me over the years. So I will say this: get in the barrel over the falls, because you've been tracked, Frankie Soya. Next time, I don't know. I guess we have to go vegetarian, and then go back.
So Josh, next week we have a couple of guests, and I sure hope they don't steal us some wine.
We've got a heavy coming next week. Oh, Soya, should we tell him? Should we
what
tell him?
What song is it? I forget this album. What?
Oh, man.
You guys don't know any heavies. There's no way that's going to happen.
All right. Well, I tried. No heavies next week. Sorry, everybody. That's all, folks. Find us at Primus Tracks on Instagram and Twitter. Frankie's at Frankie Beristein. Tim Sawyer does not want to be found, even though he is on social media. Later days.
I admire this podcast for its symmetry.
Vive la France, vive la France.